As a businessman, I would think Turkey should go into the economic community as soon as possible.
Quindi il problema non è il problema di sapere se la Turchia presenterà o non presenterà la domanda di adesione. La domanda di adesione turca o l'adesione della Turchia è già prevista nel trattato di adesione, di associazione. Il problema è vedere quando saranno riempite le condizioni perché questo ingresso possa avvenire nell'interesse comune senza suscitare urti né nell'interno della vita comunitaria né nell'interno della vita economica turca.
So Turkey's on the road to membership of the European community. But if you look at Turkey, vast and arid, it doesn't look very European. It's a rural, traditional country. The vast majority of its 45 million people, 60% of them work in agriculture. Change is slow. But the population's doubling every 20 years, and this can't go on. Over the past 30 years, the Turks have begun to build up a modern industrial sector. Most of their factories are designed to make things for the Turkish home market, like these tires or other parts for cars. It's called import substitution. But all the modern machinery has to be bought from abroad and most of the raw materials too. And to finance this, they've borrowed billions of dollars and they need to borrow billions more. Joining Europe would mean competing with countries far more advanced than Turkey.
Rakamlarımızı gelişmiş memleketlerin rakamlarıyla karşılaştırdığımızda elbette cılız kalacak. Elbette rekabet için kaygı yaratacaktır. Fakat gelişmiş memleketlerinde bu kalkınmalarını bizim gibi 30 sene gibi kısa bir dönemde değil de 150-200 sene gibi bir zamana serdiklerini, ayrıca onların bizim gibi dikenli yollarda, yokuşlarda yürüdüklerini değil de kolaylıkla gittiklerine bakarsak ümitli olmamamız için sebep yoktur.
This is our biggest immediate problem to service our debts. We must design ourselves to earn more foreign exchange. We must use less energy and we must create more energy in this country.
The apparent prosperity in Ankara's streets is deceptive. There's 100% inflation. They had a balance of payments deficit of £1.5 billion last year, and they had to borrow massively from overseas. Total foreign debts now amount to over £11 billion, £245 for every Turk. Oil price rises are the main problem, and they are now hoping to get their energy from water, from dams. On the coastal plain that runs to the Mediterranean is the Seyhan River and dam, and there you can see the pattern of the future. Around the river, the soil is fertile. But in summer, it's parched dry, giving only a sparse crop of wheat in spring when the snows melt. With dams, the landscape is transformed. In the 25 years since the Seyhan Dam was built, everything around it, towns and countryside, has changed. Over 1,500 square kilometers of farmland get water from the dam all year round. The hydroelectric power station supplies 54 million watts for local homes and factories. Before the dam, they used to plant this land hastily with wheat as the spring flood subsided. If they were lucky, the wheat would ripen before the sun parched the grain. Often, the crop failed utterly. Now, with the help of some simple technology, the cotton comes up year after year. Nature here provides good soil, warm sun, freedom from frost. Add to that man-made, year-round, reliable supplies of water, and almost anything can grow. Through the long, hot summer, the oranges swell on the branch to ripen in the cool of winter. Citrus fruits, healthy food for the local people, and the basis for exports to Northern Europe, too. It's tough work picking cotton in the autumn sun, but for the gangs of women under their male foreman, it's better than no work at all. These people are from one of Turkey's ethnic minorities. They're Arabs from the ancient city of Tarsus, where St. Paul lived. Until the dam came and regular supplies of water and regular crops of cotton and regular jobs picking it, the lives of women like this hadn't changed in centuries. Irrigation and electric power are opening up the world for them. For most of Turkey's people, dust and drought are the masters of existence. This is Mesopotamia in southeast Turkey, the cradle of civilization. Over thousands of years, mankind has reduced it to a desert. Now they're planning to make it bloom again. In the mountains to the north, a dream is starting to come true at the great dam at Keban on the Firat or Euphrates River. It's a poor, remote place, but it's the key to one of the largest land development schemes ever attempted by man. The people of the headwaters of the Euphrates are tough, famous fighters, devout, traditional. This is the region of another of Turkey's ethnic minorities, the Kurds. Harnessing the river is meant to bring them prosperity and peace. The people are desperately poor, with incomes under half the Turkish national average of £575 a head. There never have been any regular year-round jobs here. Now the people are learning new skills, carving out the rock to build a dam 200 meters high. But the equipment, of course, is imported. European capital and European know-how have to be bought to put these men to work. If Turkey can't pay its foreign debts, this whole vast scheme could grind to a halt. Without loans from abroad to buy equipment, the hopes for the future will be blighted. At present, all Turkey's exports can't even pay for her vital imports of oil, let alone for investments like this. Without massive international aid, the future looks bleak. The Southeast Anatolia water projects are already producing power, more than enough for all local needs. Eventually, they could double the nation's production of electricity. At present, Turkey imports electricity from Bulgaria and the Soviet Union, as well as importing the oil it can't afford. Transmitted across the country, the Keban's power means jobs and prosperity hundreds of kilometers away. Turkey's future in the race to meet the needs of its rapidly rising population literally depends on the success of its immense water schemes. The Western companies, German, Italian, British, and Swedish, that design the dams and power stations and sell the complex equipment, profit from its success too. The loans to finance it come from the World Bank in Washington and the European Investment Bank in Luxembourg. It's an international partnership from which everyone benefits. Far away downriver, as far as Baghdad in Iraq, nearly 5,000 kilometers away, the annual floods have already been tamed by the Keban Dam here on the headwaters of the Euphrates. Turkey's role as the link between the Middle East and Europe isn't just symbolic, it's part of the key to a future in cooperation. The wild energy of the spring floods from the Anatolian mountains has been a menace since the time of Noah. With skill and money for investment, it can become a boom. This is the shape of the future. The first dam completed is the Keban. They're now building the even bigger Karakaya Dam. They'll harness the Firat or Euphrates and the Dijle or Tigris rivers. Next year, they start building the Atatürk Dam, the third biggest in the world. If funds are available, they'll double Turkey's electricity supply, and by irrigating the Harran Plain, they'll double wheat production too. A man who used to run the state water authority is now deputy prime minister.
These projects, just considering from the electric power point of view, in many cases, with the today's cost and today's electric power prices could earn their or could amortize themselves in 3 to 4 years' time. Now, given an example of the Southeast Anatolian Atatürk project,
will produce 9 billion kilowatt hours, which means is equal to 2.2 million ton of oil. And with the present prices, it is almost $700 million. And in 4 years, $2.8 billion. That makes the project cost almost.
The electricity from the dams will by itself pay for their construction and save precious imports of oil. Year-round farming on irrigated land will make possible a new level of employment in the Turkish countryside and help stem the drift of people into the cities. This year, one ton of wheat fetched almost exactly the same price as one barrel of crude oil. The new wealth of grain from irrigated land would make Turkey an indispensable ally for its oil-producing Arab neighbors.
They have energy and oil. We have no energy and oil. They need foodstuffs. We have foodstuffs. They need water. We have water. They don't have manpower, and we have manpower. So it would be natural for us to turn to the Middle East. But we think together with this, we're a part of Europe, and we must compete in the European common market, and we must be a part of Europe.
So far, Turkey's barely scratched the surface of the profit it might make out of its relationship with Europe. The tourists are happy, but few, even on the Mediterranean coast. The highways still twisting, the villages still unspoiled. So far, the Turks have avoided the perils of mass tourism, the high-rise hotels, the polluted beaches, not so much because they didn't want it, as because they failed to organize it. In some ways, the Turks are lucky. They can still choose what kinds of tourists they want to attract. Instead of mass tourism, the Turks are starting to make the best of an even greater asset. Their country is known a bewildering succession of civilizations from the very start of human culture. This castle was probably built by a local Armenian king in the 13th century. The main visitors nowadays are airmen and their families from the local American base. But there's a fortune to be made out of Turkey's ruins and ancient sites if only the tourists aren't scared off by talk of military coups. Large areas of the country, including some of the finest remains from civilizations older than ancient Greece, are out of bounds to all foreigners. But anyone can visit the Island of the Princes, an hour's ride by ferry from Istanbul. The Byzantine rulers used to put out the eyes of potential rivals to the throne and send them here to die. Now it's a carefully preserved Victorian resort in the gentle climate of the Sea of Marmara. It offers the kind of quiet pleasure that attracts almost 2 million tourists to Turkey in a good year, with £100 million to spend. Constant devaluations of the Turkish lira have made Turkey a cheap country for visitors. Tourism brings in foreign exchange and provides jobs for the relatively unskilled too. It's another of the resources that Turkey's been slow to develop, potentially a gold mine for the future. For foreigners, the old ways are a picturesque delight. For Turks, they are something to escape from. The menace to these children's future is sheer numbers, their own numbers. Only if things go well, if foreign exchange earnings rise, if foreign loans come in, if foreign markets open up to Turkish exports, can the country possibly feed and employ the 90 million people predicted for the year 2000? The old traditional way of life simply can't continue. Yet some old traditions, especially Turkey's Islamic heritage, seem to grow stronger in the late 1970s. For Western European Christians, Islamic Turkey seems to belong by culture as well as by geography and economics, alongside its Muslim neighbors, Iran and Arabia, rather than Europe. There's no doubt, for example, that in all countries, widespread religious belief goes together with a high birth rate. And the high birth rate is Turkey's main basic problem. In the mosque, The women are invisible, admitted only to a separate gallery. Islam teaches respect for women, but confines them to a separate role in life, an idea clearly rejected in the modern Europe that Turkey aspires to join. Kemal Atatürk, the creator of modern Turkey, tried to transform it into a secular nation with rigid separation of religion and the state. But can Turkey really complete Atatürk's vision, discard its history, become European?
Atatürk bizim memleketimizi batıya dönük kabul etmiş ve stratejimizi batıya dönük olarak ayarlamıştır. Ve batıya dönüklüğümüzde lafla değildir. Arap harflerini bırakmamız, şalı, peçeyi bir tarafa koymamız, şekil olarak Arap memleketlerinin bu şeylerini bırakıp batıya gitmeyi değil, gerçekten inancımızın bu olduğunun kanıtıdır.
For many Turks, membership of the Western European economy is an accomplished fact. There may be as many as 2 million Turks working abroad. These were some of those who were eager to get away, to become units of production in the factories of West Germany. They found their way to Istanbul, joined the queue, got a medical check, and waited. Out of the waiting thousands, very few were called. They were the lucky ones who got to Germany. In late 1980, the German government imposed visa restrictions on all Turkish travelers. France and the Benelux countries followed. Germany, in a world recession, doesn't need immigrant workers anymore. In 1979, Turkish workers abroad sent home £7.5 billion, a valuable hard currency contribution. That the German and other West European economies have done well out of importing Turkish workers is not in doubt. Many Turks have benefited too. They've earned good money and they've learned some skills as well. Most Turkish migrant workers would like to take their new skills home and get jobs there. That can only happen if Europe invests in Turkey. Far from home, the Turkish migrants recreate the memory of their homeland and dream, when they have time to dream, of their distant families. Often in their first years abroad, they live the rough life of soldiers in camp. Many of them, illegal migrants these, with no work permit, create their own slums whose only merit is that they can afford to live there. These Turks are the menials of Western Europe. Their government demands for them equal rights and full membership of the community that benefits from their labor. It's natural that migrant Turks resent their inferior status, and it's natural that Germans resent the guest workers who live an inferior existence in their midst. Turkey's membership of the European community would mean equal status for Turkish and West European workers alike. That would only be possible if the economies they come from were roughly equal.
The most important thing, whether Turkey will be ready for the eventual integration with the EEC. That, I believe, the correct policies in Turkey, without considering even EEC, if it is applied. And I suggest this is the basic policies which we are following right now. These economic stabilization policies or free market economy policies. If these policies continuously followed in the coming years, then I believe Turkey will become a member of EEC.
È intervenuto il governo militare, vi sono stati dei dibattiti anche al Parlamento europeo. La situazione turca è una situazione un po' diversa dalle situazioni degli altri paesi. Nella Costituzione turca è previsto un ruolo di garante della stabilità delle istituzioni da parte dell'esercito. Certo, noi non auspichiamo che il governo militare rimanga in modo permanente in Turchia e auspichiamo che al più presto si possa arrivare alla ricostituzione di una situazione democratica. Nello stato attuale di cose noi crediamo che non si possa però condannare esplicitamente un ruolo che del resto è previsto dalla Costituzione. La tradizione del L'esercito turco è una tradizione di scelta democratica, laica ed europea. Quindi noi crediamo, siamo convinti che questo processo di ritorno alle istituzioni democratiche possa avvenire nel più breve tempo possibile.
Turkey has paid very dearly for her democracy. It cost Turkey so much that it nearly wrecked the country. And the military, I think, have intervened at the very right time. Had they been a little late, it would have been tremendously difficult to correct the situation. Although we had democracy, which we had fully, I must say, our constitution, our institutions, our labor laws and everything worked for the wrongdoer rather than the good citizen.
Noi abbiamo, ripeto, con la Turchia un trattato di associazione. Certamente la situazione dell'economia turca è una situazione abbastanza degradata e quindi gli interventi che noi facciamo sono interventi collegati a dei protocolli finanziari, a degli aiuti finanziari che diamo.
The transfer of resources from richer parts of the community to the poorer parts will be greater, there's no doubt. But I like to think that in the enlarged community, as in the present community, helping the less developed regions to develop faster than they would if left alone is in the long-term interest of everyone in the community. And economically speaking, you know, I can't help thinking of the American frontier, the discovery of the western part of the continent to a certain extent, to a limited extent. What we're doing now is an operation of that sort. We are pushing the frontier of the community towards countries which need development.
È sempre molto difficile fare delle previsioni. Evidentemente, a parte il fatto che dipende dalla volontà degli organi turchi di presentare la domanda di adesione. Fino a questo momento non esistono domande di adesione. Evidentemente io credo che il problema dell'adesione della Turchia si porrà nel momento in cui sono stati raggiunti degli obiettivi di stabilità economica e di possibilità di ingresso nella comunità senza conseguenze negative per l'economia turca e per l'economia della comunità. È una valutazione del tutto obiettiva che credo noi faremo, la comunità farà d'accordo con le autorità turche. Quindi è estremamente difficile prevedere questi tempi.
Turkey's economy needs West European capital and technology. West Europe needs Turkey for its defensive alliance, for some food supplies, as a market for exports, and as a source of labor. It could be a happy marriage, but it's bound to be a long engagement.